But in reading Legal Writing, A Judge's Perspective, I learned something I didn't know about crafting sentences. And this is again from psycholinguistics, I take it. On page 57, you state that, quote, the most emphatic part of virtually any sentence is the ending, where the reader's focus typically sharpens. We should thus generally try to use the end of a sentence for what you want to emphasize, end quote. And then you give the example of the second half of Churchill's famous sentence about having nothing to offer but blood, toil, tears, and sweat. And frankly, I wasn't aware that there was a first half to that sentence. So I suppose it merely serves as, the first half of that sentence anyway, merely served as the plinth for the statute of words that Churchill erected upon it. So your observation that readers should focus more on the end of a sentence than the beginning is one that's going to stay with me.
One of the things that cognitive psychologists have said, and this isn't a full explanation for that, but I think it is partial explanation, is they describe some wrap-up effect. And that is, when you come to a semicolon, or more so, you come to a period, even a comma, that what these cognitive psychologists tell us, Tim, is that readers will, without any intent, without any conscious design, we will slow down when we come to this, say, a terminal punctuation mark, because the explanation is that they give us is we're trying to make sure that we've understood what we've just read before we move on. And if you take, say, in the book, I mentioned there was a 305-word sentence from Martin Luther King Jr. in Letter from Birmingham Jail. And he breaks it down into 12 chunks. And I think that would be an example that if you read the first chunk and then he has a semicolon and he divides these 12 chunks primarily by semicolons, you see kind of what these psychologists are talking about, that we will, without any intent, we will slow down to make sure that we understand what we've just read before we move on. And that's why they tell us that when through the peripheral vision, we see that there's a punctuation mark, particularly terminal punctuation like a period, that our eyes will slow down when we get to the end of that clause or the near the end of that sentence.
Yeah, one thing that I thought of when reading that passage from Martin Luther King Jr.'s speech that you included in your book was that, I had a little bit of trouble adapting because obviously that was very effective in soaring oratory, but adapting that the lessons at work in that oratory to a legal brief, I was having trouble doing it, because if I were, like, if I could imagine being in a judge's shoes, reading something that I took to be as artful oratory, I might gloss over and say, okay, well, let's get back to the nitty gritty. I'm going to skim until you're finished with all the semicolons and get to a period and a new paragraph and where legal argument's going to start again. What would you say to that?
Well, it's a completely fair, a very good comment, Tim. The point that I'm trying to make with the letter from Birmingham Jail primarily is the value of breaking information into discernible chunks,
grouping, yeah,
how we process information, one familiar unit of information at a time. Few people are gonna, either judges or advocates, are gonna be able to use this soaring rhetoric in that sentence that will be productive in persuading anyone, whether it's a judge or an advocate. But I do think that if you break information into manageable chunks, sort of like when we break our telephone numbers into three digestible chunks and our three digits in the area code surrounded by punctuation, prefix before a dash, four digits after the dash, that I think you can replicate that idea from Letter from Birmingham Jail, not necessarily the soaring rhetoric, but breaking the information into 12 discernible chunks. Maybe you don't want to write a 305-word sentence, but you can use long sentences to great effect if you break the information into discernible chunks. And that's the lesson that I would hope could be drawn from a letter from Birmingham Jail.